there, AP Environmental Science class. All right, today we're going to move on to Chapter 6, which is Aquatic Biodiversity. Now, in our previous chapter, Chapter 5, we talked about terrestrial biodiversity and climate. And the reason why climate was included was because climate determines the type of biome you have, which then ultimately determines the type of biodiversity you're going to have. When we talk about aquatic biodiversity or the water, obviously climate is not going to be a factor in determining the biodiversity of regions of fresh and salt water. There are going to be other factors that are going to go into play to the aquatic biodiversity, and that's what we're going to talk about in this lesson. So first, we start off, and once again, guys, I'll break this into two parts. Each will be about 20 minutes each, all right? So the first core case study, why should we care about coral reefs? Well, coral reefs are among the world's oldest, most diverse, and most productive ecosystems. That's why we need to care about coral reefs. And unfortunately, we are seeing a lot of our coral reefs die out around the world. Coral reefs form in clear, warm coastal waters in tropical areas. Tiny animals called polyps and single-celled algae have a mutualistic relationship. The polyps secrete a calcium carbonate shells, which become the coral reefs. The algae lives inside this coral. And again, together, they work together in that mutualistic relationship. Coral reefs provide important ecological and economic services. Again, another reason why they are very important and why we need to care about them. They are natural barriers to protect coastlines from storms, from high waves. They're habitat, food, and/or spawning grounds for one quarter to one third of the ocean's organisms. So think about that. Habitat, food, and spawning grounds for 25 to 33% of the ocean's organisms. So obviously, if you get rid of the coral reefs, if the coral reefs die out, well, then up to 33% of the ocean's organisms are going to have a hard time surviving because their habitat source, their food source, and where they spawn, where they breed, all going to be gone. So again, very important that we keep these coral reefs as healthy as possible. Coral reefs are vulnerable to damage, soil runoff, climate change, all right, increasing ocean temperature will bleach the coral reefs and also increasing ocean acidity. The more acidic the ocean gets, the worse it is for the coral reef. So here's a picture of a coral reef. The white part is bleached, meaning it is dead. There is no animals living, no organisms living in that white part. And again, that's because of higher ocean temperatures and, of course, sediment going into the ocean and also the acidity of the ocean increasing as well. So again, very important that we kind of change those factors so that our coral reefs can become healthy once again. All right, 6.1, what is the general nature of aquatic systems? Saltwater and freshwater aquatic life zones cover almost three-fourths of the Earth's surface. So I think you know that over 75% of Earth is covered with some form of water. Here are the factors that determine aquatic biodiversity. So instead of biomes and climate, it's going to be temperature of the ocean, of the water, the dissolved oxygen content in the water, how much oxygen is dissolved in the water for the organisms that live there to use, the availability of food, and access to light and nutrients necessary for photosynthesis. Photosynthesis goes on in the world's ocean as primary producers are once again the bottom of the food chain, just like here on land. In the ocean, those primary producers are very important because they're the base of the food chain, and then everything builds upon them. Saltwater covers 71% of Earth's surface. Freshwater occupies another 2%. And when we talk about water usage in a couple of chapters, we'll get into that. Again, 2% of water is fresh water, and that's the only water that we can use on this planet as humans to irrigate our crops, to drink ourselves. So there's not a lot of it around, and as a result, we need to basically make sure that we keep it not polluted, that fresh water. And again, more on that to come down the road. The global ocean is divided into five areas. You have the Atlantic, the Pacific, the Arctic, the Indian Ocean, and then the Southern Ocean is basically the ocean that that surrounds Antarctica in the southern hemisphere. Okay, so those are our five ocean areas. Distribution of organisms determined largely by salinity. So how much salt is in the water is going to determine the type and distribution of organisms you have. So saltwater life zones, that's your marine life zones, oceans, estuaries, coasts, coral reefs and mangrove forests are going to have a different distribution of organisms as compared to freshwater life zones like lakes, rivers, streams, and inland wetlands. And we're going to talk about these zones in more detail as we go through this chapter. All right, so aquatic species are going to drift, swim, crawl, or cling. So first, we're going to talk about plankton. Plankton drift around the world's oceans. We have phytoplankton, which are your primary producers. For most aquatic food web, they float around on the surface and they use the sun's energy to perform photosynthesis. We have something called ultraplankton, which are actually tiny photosynthetic bacteria. So most of your phytoplankton is algae, plants, but they're actually some bacteria, which aren't plants, but they actually do photosynthesis, these tiny bacteria, and they're called ultraplankton. Again, bacteria that are photosynthetic. Then we have something called zooplankton, which are actually secondary consumers in many instances. They range from single cell to large invertebrates like jellyfish. Jellyfish will go around and eat a smaller fish, which were your primary consumers. So we have this zooplankton, which in many cases will be secondary consumers. Here you have some examples. You hear your jellyfish, the man of war, on the left side here, and then you have a starfish, which isn't a fish, on the right side here as well. Okay, so these are just some examples of some of these aquatic species. On the some other aquatic species we need to talk about, we have nekton. Nekton are strong swimmers. So fish, turtles, and whales, for instance, all go under the umbrella of nekton. Okay, so you may not have heard that term before, but again, those are your strong swimmers in these aquatic life zones. Then you have benthos. Benthos are bottom dwellers, your oysters, your sea stars, your clams, your lobsters, your crabs. They are considered benthos, okay, or into that grouping of aquatic organisms. And then finally, you have your decomposers, just like on land. They're in the ocean as well, or in aquatic environments, and we're talking mostly about bacteria when we talk about the decomposers. All right, so key factors in the type and numbers of organisms, once again, going to be that temperature, going to be that dissolved oxygen content, otherwise known as DO. You may see DO in the book, in the readings. That's dissolved oxygen. Availability of food, and of course, the availability of light and nutrients needed for photosynthesis. In addition, turbidity is going to be another factor that's going to determine the type and number of organisms. And turbidity is a degree of cloudiness in the water. Okay, so if you have a lot of sediment in your water, you're going to have high turbidity. If your water is very clean and clear, then your turbidity is going to be low. All right, so why are marine aquatic systems important? Well, saltwater ecosystems, again, provide major ecosystem and economic services. They're irreplaceable reservoirs for biodiversity. That's why these marine aquatic systems are so important. Oceans provide vital ecosystem and economic services. Oceans produce more than half of the oxygen we breathe. In addition, they provide most of the rain that sustains water supply, because where's most of that rain in the water cycle evaporating from? It's evaporating from the oceans. 110 million tons of seafood harvested per year for us humans to eat and consume. And unfortunately, the Earth's oceans are poorly understood. They could be a potential source for even more ecological and economic benefits if we just understood the oceans a little better than we do today. And maybe that's something you guys will get into as a career. Maybe you will get into that, studying the oceans more, finding those more of those ecological and economic economical benefits that the oceans can provide us. All right, so three major life zones in the ocean. First, the coastal zone, warm, nutrient-rich, shallow water in most instances, extends from the land to the edge of the continental shelf. What's the continental shelf? Well, it's basically the end of the continent, okay? Again, we have these plates moving around, so your continental plate, and then you have the ocean floor. Basically, the continental shelf is where the continental plate and the ocean floor kind of meet, and it's basically a real steep drop-off a couple of hundred miles off the coast, okay? So that's the continental shelf. Makes up less than 10% of the world's ocean area. So most of the ocean area is actually not coastal zone. It's actually open sea or ocean bottom, okay? But even though it's only 10% of the world's ocean area, the coastal zone, 90% of all marine species are going to live there. So what we're going to find out is we actually don't have a lot of creatures living in the open sea. Most, 90% of all those marine species live in the coastal zone, which only makes up about 10% of the world's ocean area. So again, very important, the coastal zone, because that's where most of your marine species are living. And obviously that's the part that's that we're in as well, right? We're impacting the coastal zone as humans much more than we're impacting, let's say, the open sea or the ocean bottom. So here we're negatively impacting where 90% of the marine species are located in the coastal zone. And obviously that's an issue. And obviously that's something that we have to rectify as we go through the next years, the next decades, and into the next century. So here are just some of the natural capital that marine ecosystems provide us. Oxygen supplied through photosynthesis, water purification, climate moderation, right? You need the oceans to keep the climate moderate to move. Again, those ocean currents we learned in the last chapter, moving warmer temperatures north, colder temperatures south to kind of keep that climate moderate. Absorbs carbon dioxide. We talked about that. Nutrient cycling in the ocean. Reduce storm damage. Again, mangroves, barrier islands, coastal wetlands will reduce the storm damage that we see on land from big waves and hurricanes, things like that. Obviously, biodiversity, species and habitats, food. We use a lot of food from the ocean, right? Eating all that seafood. Energy from waves and tides actually can be used to produce energy, to produce power. Pharmaceuticals come from the ocean. Harbors and transportation routes, okay? Obviously, people still boat and still ship things via boats, right? Recreation and tourism. Who doesn't love going to the ocean? I'm an ocean man myself. I love hanging out at the ocean. So again, we need it for our own sake. Employment and minerals as well can be pulled out of the ocean. All right, here are just some of the zones that we talked about. You'll notice upper left here is the coastal zone, where again, 90% of the creatures live. You have the estuary zones up here. Here's your continental shelf, and then it drops off. All right, so you have the open sea, which is out here. Then you have the batholithic zone, which is kind of, so you have the euphotic zone up here, which is near the light. Okay, think of photic light. Then you have the batholithic zone, which is kind of in the middle, and then the abyssal zone, which is way down here at the bottom. That's pretty much the ocean bottom, known as the abyssal zone there. Okay, so these are your zones. Definitely know them. All right, definitely know, understand in which, where they are located in the ocean. And again, water temperature drops rapidly between the euphotic zone and the batholithic zone here. Okay, and as you go down into the abyssal zone as well, your temperature is going to drop very, very quickly, as of course, most of the warmer water is at the top or near the surface of the ocean. So again, understand these zones, understand where they are in the layers, okay, and understand that most of your marine life is going to be found in the coastal zone. All right, next we move on to estuaries and coastal wetlands. They are highly productive areas. Estuaries, what is that? That's where the aquatic zone, where river meets the sea. All right, so kind of where the Hudson River goes into the Atlantic Ocean, down by the southern tip of New York City. That would be considered an estuary. Coastal wetlands, this is coastal land covered with water all or part of the year. These include your coastal marshes and your mangrove forest. We'll show you some of those mangroves in just a second. These are very productive ecosystems with very high nutrient levels, okay, in these estuaries and these coastal wetlands. And unfortunately, because these are the zones that are kind of, we're sharing a lot of it as humans, estuaries and coastal wetlands are what we seem to be degrading the fastest. And unfortunately, this is where most of your highly productive ecosystems are. So once again, just seems like we seem to degrade the worst stuff to degrade, right? The open ocean where nothing's living, we're really not bothering. Right along the estuaries and the coastal wetlands where everything is happening, we are degrading, unfortunately, the fastest. We have seagrass beds. These occur in shallow coastal waters. They can host up to 60 species of grasses and plants, and they also support a variety of marine species. So here is an estuary, a coastal wetland. You'll notice that this is a river. flowing into an ocean here. I believe this is in Mozambique. And what you're noticing is that sediment that is coming out of the river and into the ocean there. Sediment is not necessarily good for estuaries and coastal wetlands. So when you do get a lot of that sediment runoff, it definitely will affect your biodiversity. Here is one of the, again, this is just a wetland, coastal wetland, another coastal estuary type of thing that I'm sure most of you have seen if you've ever gone down the Jersey Shore. Looks a lot like this, the coastal wetlands. And then here are your mangroves, okay? This is actually taken in Thailand, but if you go down to Florida, they definitely have mangroves there as well. You'll notice the roots of the mangroves kind of go into the water there. Again, very important mangroves as barriers for waves. You can imagine waves crashing into these mangroves can protect the inland areas. You get rid of these mangroves, you clear cut them to put in maybe condos or something like that. Well, guess what? Those big waves come right into your condo. So again, mangroves, very important. And here are the seagrass, all right? This is what we're talking about when we talk about seagrass. And again, the seagrass is very important because they harbor a lot of biodiversity within those seagrasses, within those seabeds there. So again, just a couple of pictures of the things that we discussed in the slides. Rocky and sandy shores host different types of organisms. So we need to talk about the intertidal zone. This is the area of shore between high and low tide. Organisms must survive with daily salinity and moisture changes, right? So if you live in the intertidal zone, sometimes during high tide, you're going to be under the water. There's going to be obviously salt water. And then at low tide, you may actually not be covered by water. You must actually be much drier. So organisms in the intertidal zone have evolved to be able to survive daily changes in both the salinity and the moisture of their habitat. That's the intertidal zone. Rocky shores are pounded by waves, while barrier beaches, sandy shores, most organisms are going to burrow, dig, or tunnel in sand. So again, just some different, I guess, again, we don't call them biomes in aquatic in the aquatic world, but you could kind of think of it that way. The intertidal zone, the rocky shores, the barrier beaches. Again, you can kind of think of them as different biomes, and obviously different creatures have evolved to live in those different zones. And so you have biodiversity there because of the different type of environment that you get. Different creatures are going to evolve to be able to handle that environment the very best. That's what your survival of the fittest is all about. All right. So once again, just some pictures of some of these creatures. The rocky shore beach. You'll notice the sea star, the hermit crab, for instance. And then in the barrier beach, the more sandy beaches, you'll have some crabs. Maybe some something called a peanut worm there. Again, so just understand the difference in the biodiversity between these different aquatic life zones. Okay, moving on, critical concept, the importance of wetlands. So wetlands, again, are areas that are saturated with water all or part of the year. They're going to have standing shallow water with emergent vegetation. Again, I showed you a couple of pictures of those wetlands, and they're going to contain communities of plants and animals that have adapted to continuously wet conditions. So maybe different than the organisms that live in the intertidal zone, right? They've evolved to handle wet, dry, wet, dry. Well, if you live in a wetland, you have standing water all year round, so you've evolved to deal with continuously wet conditions. So what are some freshwater wetlands? Okay, so freshwater wetlands will include swamps, marshes, bogs, something called fens, and something called prairie potholes. Okay, so these are freshwater wetlands now. Again, slightly different than your saltwater wetlands, but I would say that they're kind of similar, right? Swamps are going to look kind of similar to those to the wetlands I showed you, the pictures of the aquatic, the ocean wetlands. Marshes, okay, may look similar to the mangrove forests that are on the in the saltwater wetlands. So et cetera, et cetera. But again, freshwater going to have some different environments there. Here are your saltwater wetlands. Again, the estuaries, the mangrove swamps, the coastal marshes. Again, just to compare and contrast. And again, both are going to provide many ecosystem services for us. All right. So case study, another one for you now in the book, revisiting the coral reefs. All right. So coral reefs are the marine equivalent of tropical rainforests. I think you kind of got that when I talked about how up to 33% of the ocean's organisms are reliant on coral reefs for something or another, be it habitat, be it spawning areas, etc. Reefs are being destroyed and damaged worldwide. Ocean acidification. All right. Oceans absorb carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide reacts with ocean water to form a weak acid that decreases the levels of carbonate ions needed to form coral. So that's what's happening. So the more carbon dioxide we're putting into the air, the more is getting absorbed into the ocean. And then unfortunately, that forms this weak acid that decreases the carbonate ions or the levels. And that's basically what coral is. We need those carbonate ions to form coral. Since we have less of them with more carbon dioxide being sequestered in the ocean waters, well, obviously, that's less of it to help form coral. And that's one of the reasons that the corals are beginning to die out throughout the world. All right, open sea and ocean floor host a variety of species. So now we're back in the ocean and we're talking about some of those. So we talked about the coastal zone. Now we're going to talk about the ocean sea and the open sea, and the ocean floor zones. So three vertical zones of the ocean sea. Again, we've talked about this. The euphotic zone is the top zone. Okay. And again, think of photic, think of sun, photography, photo, photons. Okay. That's where the sunlight is going to be able to penetrate. So you have a lot of phytoplankton there. Your nutrient levels are actually low. Your dissolved oxygen levels, though, are high, and upwelling will bring nutrients from below. So basically, nutrient-rich water is usually cold. It's not usually warm. So what happens is your levels are low at the top in the euphotic zone because usually the temperature is a little warmer, and then we get some upwelling, which is actually bringing colder air up to the surface. That upwelling will bring some of that nutrients from the colder water up to the surface for the plants and for the fish or any other animals or organisms that are living there. High dissolved oxygen content is important for your fish, for your organisms living in the water. And again, the euphotic zone is where you're going to have most of those organisms there. And again, they need that high dissolved oxygen. All right. Next zone is called the batholithic zone. Again, this is below the euphotic zone, dimly lit middle zone. In this zone, you're going to have those zooplankton and some smaller fishes will be found in this zone. And then at the bottom, the abyssal zone. Okay, this is actually the bottom of the ocean, dark and cold. You have a high levels of nutrients down there, but very little dissolved oxygen. And therefore, you're not going to see a lot of big fish swimming down there. You're going to have some deposit feeders and some filter feeders down there, which again, just kind of swim around with their mouths open and kind of filter whatever happens to be there. Again, there are nutrients down there, but we don't have a lot of big creatures because the dissolved oxygen content is so low. All right. Your net primary productivity is going to be low in the open sea, except in the upwelling areas. Again, and that's because we don't have the nutrients out there for that. Okay. So once again, just a picture of what we kind of talked about, movement of surface water. Here's your upwelling, bringing in some nutrients. Again, you have your fish towards the top, your zooplankton, phytoplankton here. All right. I would argue that this is the euphoic zone, that we're looking at here. Okay. In this picture. All right. So those are your zones of the ocean. All right. And that's where we're going to end part one of our journey here of aquatic biodiversity, chapter 6. And I'll see you guys in a little bit for the second part of this lesson.